Today at GM Talks, we will have a look at another essential GM skill, one of the things you need to master if you want to become a Grandmaster. It is exchange sacrifices, positional exchange sacrifices, and it is giving up the rook for a light piece. And we will have a look at it from a game. It's a quick, fast game, and I think it makes the concept kind of easy to understand. I hope so, anyway. Here we go. It is I'm playing against the international master, Gerard Welling, and it's played in Helsingor in 2019, before anyone heard about Corona. I'm white, and I open with C4, the English opening. Of course, this was specifically prepared for Welling, who always plays some slightly weird openings, and I had something I wanted to try. He plays E5, the most principal move, and this is all normal, and this is what Welling usually does. He wants to play some sort of a Dutch, but the problem is this move, I think, and already Black is slightly under pressure, and I think it's asking too much from Black's point of view. I understand the lure, getting the E and D, E and F pawn forward and wanting to attack in the F file. This is what they basically want to do. They want to play F4 and attack. This I can show with an arrow at some point, but White has a very harmonious and nice position, and there's no reason to believe that that this center will not be a target. Anyway, bishop e7, and Black is not afraid of the ending. The ending is fine for him. But I don't want to play an ending. I want to attack. And this is also very normal. h6 is normal here, and there is already. See this hole here, so White want to play something like this, and if he is allowed to put the pawn here, the g6 pawn will be weak. We also see that this pawn, this square is weak, and all the white squares are weak. So even though this bishop down here looks like a bad bishop, it's not so bad actually. Okay, and I saw that Welling had this position before, and he played this move, and I thought, this cannot be right. Come on, what are you doing? G5. And I immediately played this move, and this is a strong move. The idea is to isolate our friend here and attack it with F3, and especially this hole here is created, and I think Black's dream of a kingside attack is a long way out in the future. He played c5, it's kind of Benoni setup, and I didn't mind. I played f3, attacking pawn, weakening the white squares even more. I'll take back with the pawn, and this is an important concept. The e-file here is clearly in my advantage, especially this square e6, which we will see later, is a problem. Black wants to put something here, but White can always push it away with f4. Knight bd7, castle, knight f8. It's all covering this square here, but that doesn't change that this is a sort of an eternal weakness. Queen c2, eyeing this diagonal. Also, I expect him to put his knight on g6, and I'm just developing here, and normal moves, knight g6, and that's what he's planning to do. Black is sort of massing all his pieces on the king side and hoping that they will be able to launch an attack on my king. This is what I'll call the Larry Christensen approach to chess, that when when you don't know what to do, just put all your pieces near the opponent's king and try to mate him. And if you see Larry Christensen's game, it's like that. They sort of wander towards your king. You can just see them like the wildlings from Game of Thrones or something. Anyway, all logical, normal moves. And here decided, okay, I would like to fix this pawn on f5. I want to win it later. So I play f4. Sort of fixing the structure on the king side. He would love not to have to take, but he, not to, to move forward, but he actually have to, because if he takes, I'll just take with a knight, and he will be sitting with three weak pawns. Some like here, and I take here, and then here, here, and here are all weak. So so he has to try and stay. And I go here, and he played a6, and it's white to move. And you know what the theme was? It was positional exchange sacrifices. Now, when you start out playing chess, you learn that a rook is worth something like 5 points, and a light piece is worth, a knight or a bishop is worth something like 3 points. And 5 minus 3 is 2. So sacrificing the exchange is the same as sacrificing 2 pawns. But usually when you sacrifice the exchange, you will get at least 1 pawn. So it's only 1 pawn. And if you then also get some additional advantages, then it becomes much more. And actually, the funny thing is, if you ask the computer, that's pretty materialistic. To think of this, it says that after white's next move, white is winning. Totally, absolutely winning. Because black's position just collapses completely. And, well, Gordon Gekko said that greed is good, but sometimes it's not so good. And, well, if you remember the movie Wall Street, it didn't well end so well for him. So maybe in this position, it's greed is not... Maybe you should just be generous. And white played... Have you all guessed it? Yeah, I played rook e6. And what does that do? It sort of sit there like a paralyzing factor. If black is to take, he must take, then this bishop will become a monster on this diagonal. By playing this move, white also attacks this pawn. And if that goes, then this will go. And if f5 goes, this knight is hanging, and h6 might be hanging. And where is black's counterplay here? At the moment, he really can't cover this, because if he played something like knight h7, white will just take on g4. Oh, he can just take on g6, so he can't even move the knight. So he has to take. Okay. He took. And here, Gerard, who's a friendly fellow, he was thinking, but there's really nothing that works. F5 is a goner. It will go, and white will be with 2 passed pawns. But also, he has extremely good pieces. And this guy here, the bishop, is worth a rook alone. It is so strong that you would easily sacrifice an exchange for that piece alone. Anyway, he played knight e8. There's trying to cover f5, but it allows knight takes d4. There's this trick, which shows that sometimes it's not nice to have all these pieces over here, because they're hanging. White is also threatening h6 and f5, and he would then have four connected passed pawns on the king side for the exchange, and that's more than enough. That's way too much. So he went here, covering the pawn, went here, attacking this guy again. So I got 2 on it, and he's got 1 defending. And if you also see that the king here is not too happy. You cover that one, and I play this move. And here he resigned. It's worth analyzing a little bit, but he's basically losing everything. This will go down very, very, very badly for Black, and he will lose at least a piece, and maybe even more, because f5 is falling, and after that the disaster here is evident. The knight will be lost, and there's also at the moment this knight doesn't seem to do anything, but in a moment it will go here, and then the bishop will go here, and everything will be aiming at his weakened king that has no pawn cover. So Black spared himself for further and resigned, and this, of course, rook e, if you go back, this rook e6, I think I could never have played this move when I was a junior, because it's a rook, and we all know rooks. They take your pawns in the ending, and you're gonna miss it if you lose a rook. But when I became a grandmaster, this became very evident that this was, of course, the way to play. Rook e6 is simply winning in this position. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this. Remember to like and subscribe, and there will be, of course, more videos and more GM skills and historical events. And if you have any ideas, please don't hesitate to write them in the comments. Thank you for watching.